Welcome to Pantisocracy, and this is your host, Miss Panti Bliss.
Thank you. I know you're only doing that because I am too sexy for this dress and cool marks for observation, and normally it wouldn't matter, and today it particularly doesn't matter because the thing is, you see, when people first heard that I was going to be doing a show called Pantisocracy, I suspect that loads of them thought, she's going to be talking about sex all the time, and then they were disappointed. But finally, in season 4, no more disappointment, because this is the show that we are going to be talking about sex and the Irish. So, to help me talk about sex, not that I need that much help, but I do today. We have 4 wonderful guests in our parlour today. First of all, let me introduce you to the self-titled joy bringer, Miss Taryn De Vere. Warm Pantisocracy welcome. Now, there will be photographs on the website so listeners can check out what she's wearing, because she's wearing, how would you describe your own headwear, Taryn?
It's like spread eagled legs.
Yes, it is.
With a sort of vulva created by my own hair, and
yes,
then like a little hand coming down, touching certain parts of the hair.
You thought you were just coming to like a little kind of chat show thing, and now you've met a vulva made of hair. She is coming today all the way from Donegal, and she's a woman known for these sort of colourful ensemble, although she is an Australian originally. Yes, she followed a man here, of course, don't we all? And she has long made Ireland her home for herself and her 5 children up in Donegal. So once again, for Taryn De Vere. Next to Taryn is a, can I say hunky and not make you feel uncomfortable, is a hunky former professional football player, Mr. Richie Sadlier. These days, of course, he's on the telly talking about sport rather than playing it, but he's also a psychotherapist, and for the last few years, he's been involved in running sexual health and consent workshops with teenage boys. So once more, welcome, Richie. And then we have a woman who, quite frankly, sells sex and pleasure. It's Shawna Scott of Sex Siopa. And like Taryn, Shawna is also a blow-in from Seattle in the United States, but she did Seattle here. Because she also fell in love with a fella and followed him here. But since then, she's become, as she says herself, a smut seller, determined to put pleasure back into the lexicon of Irish sex talk with her online sex shop, Sex Siopa, which is particularly female friendly. And so please welcome Shawna again. Then on the other side, we have a man who's made a career out of studying the sexual habits of the Irish. It's academic Paul Anthony Ryan. And now Paul's research ranges from the story behind the gay rights movement to Angela McNamara's Agony Ann column to sex workers and digital dating or hookups. And yes, mothers out there, that is now a career. So please welcome our very own sex doctor, Paul Ryan. And in the tradition of leaving fine wines to last, we've got 2 beautiful women that I have known for a long time. They are musicians and social change activists. Please welcome Carole Nelson and Maria Walsh of the funky, jazzy twosome Zrazy. Now, Carole hails from England, but we won't hold that against her, and Maria from County Tipperary, like her next-door neighbour there, Dr. Paul. And they were, once upon a time, sweethearts. But that love affair crashed and burned and became a friendship, but the threesome that they have with music has endured. Yes. And by the way, see, now here's something important. If you think that Richie Sadlier here is the only man of sport here, you would be wrong, because these 2 women are huge sports fans, and they are also responsible for a sporting achievement, probably bigger than anything Richie has ever achieved, to be honest, because they have done something that is part of the Irish national psyche. And you all know, and will join me, I'm sure, in Ooh Aah Paul McGrath. I said Ooh Aah Paul McGrath. I said Ooh Aah Paul McGrath. I said Ooh Aah Paul McGrath. That is up there with Billie Jean for a bass line. Ladies and gentlemen, these 2 women sitting here in front of you are responsible for that part of our national psyche. That is impressive, right? And the weird thing is, how I've known you guys for 20 years, and I did not know that. You are national treasures, but you should be, you know, like on the sides of buses and stuff. Anyway, look, we're going to get to our guests in just a moment, but before that, I get to talk to you about my own history of sex and sexuality. You see, the thing is that I don't feel old, and I think we can all agree that given the right amount of alcohol, distance, light, and macular degeneration, I still look pretty fine. But occasionally, I am confronted with the yawning gap that exists between me and, well, people that I don't think of as that much younger than me. For example, last weekend, when I was chatting to a friend of mine, I made a casual reference to Bo Derek. And he looked at me totally blankly and said, "You wanted to be the big bloke who used to present Nationwide?" Now, there are other times I'll be telling, say, the current Mr. Bliss, who's somewhat younger than I, you know, some story from my childhood or something, or more worryingly, even from my college days. And I can see him sort of looking at me and thinking how quaint and old-timey it sounds. But one of the subjects that inevitably makes me feel like Laura Ingalls Wilder when talking to millennials is sex. Because, you see, in common with most people from my generation, the mysteries of sex and sexuality were teasingly, slowly revealed to me over the years, decades, epochs even. You know, the mechanics, the possibilities, the variety, the pitfalls, the maneuvers, you know, all drip-fed to me through rumour and nudges and overheard snippets, through Jilly Cooper novels and Richard Gere movies, through trial and error, embarrassed fumbles, giggling mistakes, and more experienced lovers and happy accidents. And each new discovery was another exquisitely exciting step on a magical mystery tour that even now I am occasionally surprised and delighted to find out that it hasn't quite run out of track. But my younger friends just turned on their modems at home while their parents were out, and the internet poured every possible and some you'd think impossible position and proclivity in full color surround sound, anatomically correct pornographic detail into their teenage laps in one huge, lubricated, terrifying, exciting, shameless, overwhelming data dump. Now, call me old-fashioned, but I'm glad that I got the mystery tour. My burgeoning teen sexuality was just too confusing and too alien to deal with properly at school. So for the most part, I just ignored it. Of course, as I went through my teenage years, I started to suspect that I might be gay, but that was still such an alien concept, you know, so foreign, so Protestant, so removed from my actual experience that I mostly ignored these uncomfortable suspicions. I had never met, or even seen, to be sure, a real, actual, bona fide homosexual. So the idea that I might actually be one was, well, almost impossible to process. You might as well have wondered if I were a unicorn. You know, I wasn't actually totally sure that gays really actually existed, you know, invented to be the subject of schoolyard jokes and played for smutty laughs on sitcoms, because there were no gays in my world. There was no hairdresser with trendy tattoos in my local mother's salon. There was no lesbian couple breeding dogs on my vet father's client list. There was no Graham Norton being casually gay on the telly. No Will Young singing about boyfriends on the radio. No Anna Nolan being a lesbian nun on Big Brother. You know, even my toothy, tanned, big-haired, and short-shorted George Michael was straight at the time. There was only the pathetic Mr. Humphreys, swishing and flapping his way through Grace Brothers department store, leaving a trail of canned laughter in his wake. There were, of course, gays to be seen on the TV, even in my youth and in magazines, but they either didn't identify themselves as gay at the time, or we simply didn't recognize them as such. You know, when the Village People appeared on the telly in the 1970s, the boys of Ballinrobe's Christian Brothers in National School just thought that they were five fun guys who'd like to dress up and, you know, be creative. You know, we simply had no frame of reference for a leather queen. And when Boy George first appeared on Top of the Pops, I remember so clearly the next day was all we could talk about. But the big discussion was all whether he was a boy or a girl. The idea that he might simply have been a flaming queen never entered our minds. Now, that may seem incredible now, you know, that we didn't just assume that Larry Grayson or Kenny Everett or Vincent Hanley were gay, but they were not casually referring to hot guys on chat shows or discussing husbands in the TV Guide. And, you know, what did an 11-year-old boy in Ballinrobe, County Mayo, know about, you know, mustaches or check shirts or faded jeans or any of the other telltale signs of 70s and 80s urban homosexuality? Absolutely nothing. And it was actually in my parents' library that I first confirmed the existence of gay men. Because among the books, I discovered a yellow-paged, dog-eared copy of The Naked Ape by zoologist Desmond Morris. Now, Morris's book was one of the very first, you know, sort of popular science books, you know, to look at humans as animals and compare them to other animals. And like any curious, you know, boy of my age would, I skipped all the boring parts and went straight to the chapter on sexuality. And within that chapter, there was a subsection on homosexuality. And it was a revelation to pubescent me, you know, because Morris, he calmly and very matter-of-factly described what homosexuals were and what they did. Now, there was some dodgy 1960s Freudian comments on what might make homosexuality in males, you know, domineering mothers and weak fathers and all that nonsense. But other than that, he mostly just presented the facts. No opinion, just facts. And for the first time ever, not only did I have solid proof that gay people existed, but more thrillingly at the time, for the first time ever, there was someone, an obviously smart and respected man, a doctor even, who wasn't laughing at homosexuals or judging them or denouncing them. He was simply describing them. In fact, he went so far as to specifically say that from a detached zoological perspective, there was nothing to judge, and that in some particular situations, it could even be argued that homosexuality was biologically moral. And that thrilled me. And I read it over and over and over again, and I read it sexually excited and intellectually giddy, because here I was, you know, what I was reflected back at me, you know, in black and yellowed white for the very first time. And it was so thrilling, it was actually terrifying, so terrifying that I would slam the book shut and shove it back under my bed and try to forget all about it till, you know, the next time I crawled in under the bed to get it again with my heart in my homosexual mouth. Hi. It's funny because we all have the origin story of how we discovered sex and all, and it's one of the questions I love to ask people normally, because it's always interesting and different depending on who you are and where you came from and what your family is like. Although I think in the future that question is going to become boring because the answer is going to be the same from everybody. Pornography on their phone or something. Let's start with you, Taryn. I have to, because you're wearing that ridiculous and fabulous hat. So, you know, how did you discover sex and sexuality?
So I did have a pretty sex positive upbringing, and Australian education system at that time was reasonably sex positive. Like we learned how to put condoms on bananas when I was a 15-year-old, you know, things like that. So I had quite a good, well-rounded sex education in terms of that type of sex. But what was kind of interesting for me was that I didn't really discover that I was actually bisexual until I was 40, even though I'd had sexual experiences.
How old are you now?
I think, am I 42?
What year are we talking about that in, you know, the 15-year-olds in Australia were putting condoms on things?
Yeah. So, you know, I discovered that I was bisexual, which was really weird because I'd had sexual experiences with women and I'd been attracted to them. But I had always just assumed I was heterosexual because everybody's heterosexual.
But so your sex education, in a sense, in school was relatively forward-looking, whatever.
It was.
Bisexuality wasn't something you had ever...
That part of my education was probably lacking.
Yeah.
I grew up with around a lot of adults who were comfortable being nude, mm-hmm. and so the naked body didn't bother me, and, you know, I didn't have any of the shame and embarrassment that a lot of people seem to have around
shame and embarrassment is like an Irish national sport. So the people who were educated in Ireland, so Richie, you had a single sex, it was a school, who was running it?
I actually work in the school now, delivering the sexual health module, but I went there, it was De La Salle School.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So the only reference to sex that I remember was in the reproduction chapter of the biology section of your science. Like what goes where, and that was it. There was no discussion around anything else. And I didn't really grow up in a house where nothing like how Taryn described at all.
Yes.
There's no discussions, there was no openness.
Yeah.
Just don't mention it. It doesn't exist.
I guess you picked up stuff in the playground or whatever, like, you know, I did. Where did you get your education?
Well, actually, I suppose the one bit of formal input I got from my parents, it was excruciatingly embarrassing for me at the time. I was, I think, in the first couple of months of first year, so I would have been 13, and I snogged a girl after the local youth club disco behind the school. And somehow my mum got talking to her mum and they found out. She said it to me one day and she mentioned the girl's name and that she knew something had happened. And she handed me a book the following day and said, "Would you read that?" And I did.
But what kind of book?
Oh, it was only basic Anne and Barry type, you know.
Yes, yeah.
But
yeah.
There was no follow-up discussion. There was no come to us if you have any follow-up questions or let's explore this more. It was, we've given you the book. You said you've read it. that's our job done.
Yeah.
And I mean, I was happy with that.
Yeah. I didn't object to that. That was fine. That was more than enough.
Now, Maria, you went to boarding school in Ireland.
Yes.
Where, in County Tip somewhere?
In Tipperary, yeah.
Was there a formal sex education?
Oh, no. No, not at all. Convent of Mercy nuns, it didn't exist. Sex didn't exist. But of course, because it was a boarding school, mm-hmm. there was lots of passions and unrequited yes. passions and very little physical aspects to it, but longings, you know, Midshin in uniform comes to mind, you know, that old film.
I've also sort of envied girls that you're almost allowed as teenage girls to have like crushes.
Yes.
You know, where boys aren't.
Yes, and girls are allowed to kind of link and be more physical yes, with each other. Yeah. That's a real little liberation that females have. And
well, in this culture, but you know, then you go to Arab countries or whatever and the men are all walking around holding
yes.
hands. And it's confusing, to be
it
honest.
It is confusing, yes.
But so where did you find out about sex?
Well, if I'm honest, sex came in the form of exploring with other kids of mm-hmm. my age. You know, I'll show you mine if you show me yours. Mm. There was a quite regular exposure by old men.
In County Tip?
Yeah, in County Tip.
God.
Yes, you know, you'll always get some dirty old fella, you know, trying it on or something. Yeah. So that was really quite common. But the other aspect would be, because I'm a farmer's daughter, I noticed that the cows in the fields, now urbanites out there don't know that cows are all female, a cow is a female, but the cows, they would mount each other.
Okay? Yes, yeah.
And I
yeah.
knew that they were all female, and I thought, that's really fascinating. Absolutely fascinating.
So the classic lesbian backstory, yeah.
So that gave me great heart. I knew that there was two female things going on, you know.
But you was on the farm. Presumably you saw opposite sex animal no. couples.
No, back then it was the AI man.
Oh, right, yeah.
Not a bull, so you wouldn't see the bull. And we were always, as kids, you know, shunted away by my father. You know, you can't see this. But actually, of course, I did.
Now you're Tipperary too,
also,
Dr.
We just discovered this when we yes. sat down, also Tipperary. And I suppose mine was this perfect storm of being from a rural area but not being a farming area.
Yeah.
So when you grow up in the country, everyone presumes you're a farmer. So we were like country town, and so there was none of that learning from the yeah. land or cows mounting each other. There was nothing at home, nothing from
school was Christian Brothers.
It was a Christian Brothers school, yeah. So I remember a science book,
yeah.
so it would have been that type of discussion of reproduction or something like that. Page 138, I can still remember. So it's funny. So yeah, straight to find that out. But similarly, as Maria said, yeah. I remember being involved in a youth group with this like very unpleasant, sleazy man around. And even at that age, just knowing that there was a sense of danger
yeah.
or it just wasn't right. And it was unspoken, of course. Wouldn't have told anyone at the time. So you knew to be careful, or you knew that there were certain people you'd be careful around.
Yeah. Now, Carole, you were born in England, so you saw your parents having sex and everything, right?
No. No, in fact, we were sent to Sunday school. We were brought up Methodist, not particularly religious. And it was years later that I realised my parents sent us off to Sunday school so they could have sex. I thought... What they said was they were doing the washing. That was a Sunday morning thing. All the laundry would get done. And in fact, they were having sex.
Did you have to sit down with your parents? Or did you have something in school? Or it was just all...
Nothing. Nothing at all. I think everything I learned was from my peer group friends and from my older brother. Mm. But there is a kind of an association for me between music and sex, because I remember going to my first piano lessons and it was this old guy, Mr. McDaniel. And if I got there early, I could sit under the sofa and pull out old Titbit magazines that had photographs of naked ladies in them. So Audrey Swinburne would be finishing her class and I'd be going, I don't believe what I'm seeing. So, yeah, that was my...
Definitely
latent sexuality
does it better.
There.
Yeah. Now, Shawna,
yeah.
you grew up in Seattle.
Yes.
And so it was an open, everybody, hippie.
It's weird. Seattle's very liberal. We're very much like Washington State is a very blue, like yeah. liberal state. But we do kind of have these conservative pockets. Mm. So Puyallup, the town that I'm from.
What?
Puyallup.
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 I don't believe that.
We have the state fair, and our tagline is "Do the Puyallup."
and this is where I come in. Yeah. And yeah, so I got a lot of like mixed signals where we had comprehensive like state-funded sex education where we did the condom on a banana, all that stuff. But then they followed it up with an abstinence-only educator. And similarly, like with my parents, my mother was very progressive and that like as soon as she got a hint that me and my sister might be becoming sexually active, she got us down to our GP and got us both on birth control. But also followed it up with saying, like, it's, you know, it'd be best if you waited until marriage. And I was like, did you and dad wait till marriage? And then she was like, no. And I'm like, okay, well, then there you go.
But it was interesting reading about you because your mother was Christian.
Yeah. So my...
Like evangelical Christian?
Evangelical Christian.
And yet... When it came to her, yeah.
And yeah, but when it came to her daughters, she was like, no, we need to like make sure that you guys aren't going to get pregnant before you're ready. So down to the GP, we went and got put on the pill at the same time.
God, I love a bit of practical hypocrisy.
Yeah.
Now, Paul, you have dedicated to studying the Irish and sex and all that. The obvious big change now is the whole advent of the internet.
It's continuing to evolve. I mean, I think it's interesting listening to the different experiences from different countries. And there's always, with the Irish piece, there's always this idea that Ireland is different.
Yeah.
There's a weird exceptionalism.
Yeah.
But actually, compared to England, Britain at the time, for example, in the 60s, it wasn't that dissimilar in the north of England to what it was in Ireland. I mean, my work has kind of covered both the 1960s and the 70s, kind of right up to looking at how people are meeting online. I'm particularly looking at kind of sex work and male sex work and how people are using this in kind of wonderful creative ways to kind of buy intimacy and buy all a range of different things, you know.
Well, so, I mean, that is an absolute sea change. From being introduced to the idea of sex by cows mounting each other to being able to turn on a phone and it sort of coming at you whether you wanted to or not in a way.
Yeah, and I think there's an older generation, let me say. I mean, I think there is this sort of fear of younger people and it's like, you know, we didn't have this in our day and I don't know this. But I mean, again, the research shows that young people are pretty savvy. They're not sitting in front of a computer chatting to strangers in Illinois that they know nothing about. I think we have to give young people a little bit more credit, I think.
Now, Rich, you've focused on teenage boys and consent and all that. Does the internet and all of that affect them differently than the way we learned about sex? Well, I'll tell you, there's two things that I immediately just, without having any expertise in the area. One is, I liked the journey because small things were exciting to me because I thought that was the biggest thing you could do. And then over the course of my life, you discovered other things. Whereas, if you're 17 now, you already know all the stuff that I didn't know till I was 30, then 40, whatever. And the other thing is, occasionally I might accidentally wander onto a sexy website and down the side, I'll see these like little pictures of heterosexual pornography and that, and it makes me feel weird because it's also sort of violent looking. Is that a real issue or am I just being granny here? And
well, I do a 6-week module with transition year lads and we have an hour and a half class on porn and we just tease out, we don't do it in any kind of a judgmental, you shouldn't be, or finger wagging approach at all. It's just really to tease out with them, what are their attitudes about sex based on what they're watching in porn, and why porn is relevant is because it's filling the gap. Teachers don't do it. Parents are sometimes awkward about it. Older siblings don't talk openly about it. So if you mentioned the age 17 there, like the lads typically in our class will see porn for the first time somewhere between 11 and 13. And now I obviously don't go in looking for details, how often do you watch it and how many times a week and blah, blah, blah. But that's generally the experience. Very rarely you would get a fella say he didn't see it until, like for the first time, until 14 or 15. It's generally 11 to 13. And you'll get lads who'll say it below that.
And I think the casual observer would say, God, that's so young to know all that stuff or see all that stuff.
If a kid now has a smartphone with unlimited access to the internet and there's no parental control, which is a difficult thing for parents to properly grasp, kids are curious and their sexuality is emerging at this age. Like, it's appropriate to be curious about sexuality at that age, but now they have access to all sorts of footage and films which sometimes could be unhealthy for them to see. So we just accept all that. Mm-hmm. So we don't go in there with the approach, we're going to change your behaviours here. By the end of this module, none of you will be interested in all this. It's really to tease out what their expectations are and what they think sex involves if porn is their only teacher.
And how did it come about, the whole workshop thing?
Well, I kind of shifted the focus of my psychotherapy practice to adolescence about 3, 4, 5 years ago. And the more I was working with them, the more I realized this topic was coming up. And I did a mental health module initially in my school. And again, this topic kept coming up. And a few things happened at the same time. One of the staff members had read Louise O'Neill's novel, Asking for It.
Yeah.
I had a couple of clients in my practice that were in difficulty in this area. And it was just a conversation in school one day. And they said, this whole consent thing, is there anything we can or should be doing? And at the time, I'd been having discussions with another couple of people. And I said, I know who to contact. I contacted a woman called Elaine Burns. She's a psychologist down in NUI Galway. And we just cobbled together something. And on a trial and error basis, it just evolved. So we've been doing it about 2.5 years, covering all the things that you think would be appropriate to discuss. So consent is one aspect of that.
And what surprised you to learn from, you know, these teenagers?
How comfortable they are to talk about it when you create an environment which is open and non-judgmental. Mm. And you just try to de-shame the whole space.
Which is really, Taryn, your parenting style. You're very open with the kids, answer any questions they have, all about consent, down to hugging with uncles and all that. Why was that so important to you in parenting?
It's particularly important for me because I've experienced a lot of sexual assault and been raped twice in my life. And I really was very aware that I don't want that to happen to my children, and mm-hmm. I don't want my children to do that to other people. Mm-hmm. That would be my kind of worst nightmare idea. So for me, it was about teaching my kids about consent and body autonomy mm-hmm. is a really important practice in kind of creating the type of society that I would like to live in and that I would like my children to live in, which is one where we are all respectful of each other's bodies mm-hmm. and respectful of each other's body autonomy. Just slightly off the back of what Richie said there about the pornography, I think the important thing is if you have that sort of energy of no stigma and shame with your children, I have said to my kids, you will see things that are alarming when you're on the internet. And when you see something that's alarming, come and talk to me about it because you don't have to deal with that on your own. Yep. And it's inevitable, even if you do have parental controls, they have friends who have things and they show each other. I mean, you just cannot stop kids from seeing this stuff. So what you have to do is you have to tell them, prepare them for it before they see it and let them know this is the pathway to get help. Okay. And I also make sure as my kids are older that I would talk a lot about, do you understand that a lot of pornography is actually not really reflective of most people's experience of sex? Mm. And that, you know, I have said to my older teenage children, there are feminist porn sites if you'd like me to give you the addresses if that's what you're into, you know, that
Thanks, Mom.
A bit more healthy. You know, they're more kind of healthy porn. If you want to look at porn, then this is kind of porn where consent and body autonomy is involved in it, you know. Mm. So I'm probably the most open person in my house, despite my efforts with my children.
But how does that go down in Donegal?
My kids provide a lot of sex education for their friends and sometimes for their friends' parents.
Oh, right. Yeah. How old is your oldest?
My oldest is 18.
God, and so, you know, when you're in the teenage years, you know, everybody wants their mom to be just the same boring mom that everybody has. Yeah. Like, has she ever said, oh, shut up, you know?
Yeah, they all go through different phases, really. I think when they get to the teenage years, they're actually quite grateful and they'll come home and they'll say, oh, mum, you know, this friend of mine was saying that you don't have to use birth control if you're, you know, in the week after your period. And I said to her, no, that's not right. And she didn't believe me. And I said, well, I'm going home to check with my mum, you know. And she comes back and then she goes back into school and she says, no, you don't. You have to use birth control. You know, you could get pregnant at that time. So they come and they talk to me and they're quite glad that I can and be a reliable source of information for them and their friends at that point.
Zrazy, ladies, I'm not coming to you just because you're lesbians, but I am. Because it is funny, you know, the experience of, you know, gay people is different, isn't it? Because, you know, the straight stuff is out and about and sort of everywhere. In a way, we can model stuff from TV, movies, all that stuff. But certainly in our day, there was nothing to model off. So how did you discover that side of your sexuality?
For me, I was having sex with my boyfriends and my girlfriend and I, my best girlfriend and I, we found a book called How to Please Your Man in Bed and we pored over this together. And then we found this chapter which said, invite your best friend to join you in a threesome. And then we just couldn't get out of that chapter.
What was this book? I bet you bought that in England. Now, you're going to do the first of two songs for us. Maria, do you want to tell us about it?
Shall we do Heaven Is Here?
Sure.
Yes, Heaven Is Here. And this is on our most recent album, The Art of Happy Accidents. Mm. You did the video images for...
the 2015 marriage referendum. We just took images from that and we made a really nice little video. And it's a very sweet, happy love song. Mm. We'd had enough of all the misery and heartache. We just a sweet little happy love song called Heaven Is Here.
Yes, well, let's hear it.
Heaven was a place up in the sky, and if I was good and if I was lucky, I would go there when I die. Up somewhere beyond the stars, up. Voice behind me, a voice I know and love, saying, you're looking in the wrong place, darling. There's only space and stars above. Oh, up, 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 you give me heaven with your smile. Up, up, up. Around me at the beauty of this world. I know that love is all that matters. It's more precious than gold and pearls. Up, 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 somewhere beyond the stars. Up, 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 and heaven's been here all the while.
Gorgeous. Thank you so much. Shawna,
yes.
You came here, there was a man involved, wasn't there?
Yeah.
You know, like
yeah.
A lot of blow-ins, that's how it happens. And now that relationship ended, and do you have an other? And But so it's a long story. But you then decided very entrepreneurially to start an online sex shop.
Yes.
You call it Sex Siopa to sort of mark it out as Irish in a way, I guess. And it's also super female friendly. It's lots of curved lines and deep purples and stuff when you're online. So, well, tell me how that came about. I mean, how does a nice girl from Seattle, from Potchewatsi, Minnesota, end up with an online sex shop in Ireland?
Yeah, it kind of came about just really organically. I love my vagina and I love my clit, and I just wanted what was best for them, to be honest.
No, there were was, you getting bad sex here?
I'm not going to go into that. No, basically, what it boiled down to is I had a vibrator, and my vibrator was dying a death, and I needed a new one. So I was going into lots of shops in Dublin, and I just wasn't a kind of customer experience that I was hoping it would be. It's a lot of male-dominated spaces. And so the next time I was in Seattle, I went to the big female-founded sex shop called Babeland. And natural light does a lot for a shop. And I, natural light and good yes. displays and stuff. And the staff all really knew what they were talking about. And it was a much lovelier shopping experience. Yeah. And I got a vibrator, and then I texted my friend Tara, who I just realized is in the audience, and this is the first time I've told that story with her in the same room. And I was
hi, Tara, you slut.
And I was like, Tara, I think I want to start a sex shop. And she was like, I think that we should do that. And so we did market stalls together. And then
market
she,
stalls?
Yeah.
Whatever, the Christmas market.
Like kink events and stuff.
Okay.
And we did lovely hand poured candles and things and little birches, things that you could hit each other with. And we did that for a while, and then she started her own design business and was like, look, I really want you to move forward with this. So please keep doing this. And so I did, and then a year later I opened up Sex Siopa in its current iteration.
And what did your nice Christian Seattle mother think?
Oh, she's no longer in the church. But
they drove her out after hearing about Sex Siopa.
Yeah. They're really happy. I think they were both less worried about me running a sex shop and more worried about me starting a business in the middle of a recession, because this all started in 2012. And what I told them was this is the best time to start a business because it's only going to go up from here. There's no way it can bust. And parents are always concerned about what your children's future is going to look like. And I think they were kind of worried about that. Both of them had very stable jobs. My father is a firefighter and my mother worked in retail. And so I think they were kind of worried about me being more entrepreneurial than me selling dildos for a living.
Okay, well, I mean, I totally get that. You know, tell your parents that you're making a living dressing up as a woman. two of the things, things about the shop struck me as interesting. One is that around 50% are men.
Yes.
Especially when, if you look at your website, it's clearly aimed at a female audience, I would say.
Yes.
Okay, and then the other very interesting thing is that the age profile of your customers is getting older.
Yes, absolutely.
So what do you think accounts for that?
I think that because I'm trying to get the word out there that there's a lot of ageism, the way we talk about sex. We don't see a lot of that in pop culture. We don't see a lot of that represented in pop culture. And so when I'm doing interviews, I want to remind people that hey, once you're postmenopausal, you're still going to be able to have sex. And in some cases, you might want it more than you did when you were in your 20s. So just trying to get that message out there. And I noticed that a lot of younger people and people from Dublin like to email when they have a question, and older people and people from down the country want to ring you up and have the chats about it. So I get a lot of phone calls from people down in the depths of Kerry and Clare who want to ring up because they don't have a local sex shop, or they wouldn't be caught dead in their local sex shop, but they need to talk to someone about it, so they ring up me, which is great. It feels like a massive honor that they would put their trust in this complete stranger up in Dublin.
And what kind of thing do you, as an older Irish lady, tell you about her sex life?
So the one that really struck me was a woman from Down in Kerry whose husband had died a couple years previous, and she didn't want to do internet dating. There was no one in town that took her fancy, but her sexual frustration was such that she felt like she really needed a vibrator. And she was like, I love my husband, I don't want to date anyone else, but I want to be able to remember him and be able to get off at the same time. So I recommended a vibrator to her, and I just just, I included a book that I wrote the foreword to. It was a collection of Irish women's sexual fantasies. And it had like sexual fantasies from women all across the country. I think there was one or two that was in Osgoiliga. And yeah, just sent that off with her vibrator and just said like, you know, wrote a little note for her and said, like, I hope this helps.
And is it true though that you also hear from older women that they've maybe never had an orgasm?
Yeah, I'm hearing from more and more women that have never had orgasms before, and it usually comes off the back of a divorce as well. like recently divorced, never had an orgasm.
And were they faking it during a relationship?
They must have been.
Blame Meg Ryan. now, Dr. Paul, so if you were to look at the Irish experience and all of the research and the nerdy stuff that you do, is there anything that makes it different than, you know, other similar-ish countries?
I mean, just picking up on some of those things, I think it's interesting. I just remember when, you know, Anne Summers opened up in the 90s, and there was a big furore about it. You know, selling dildos on Collins Street. Was that an appropriate trade, you know? And also this idea, like, that your parents, Sean's parents, just saying about, you know, interest in the commerce of it. I mean, that's really where we're at the moment. It is an industry that is in part of, it's mainstreamed. It is part of the leisure industry, yeah. You know, so it's out of back streets onto high streets now.
Yeah.
Whether Ireland is different in relation to that, well, it's funny because I wrote this book about Ireland in the 60s and 70s, and I was looking at these to an agony and to Angela McNamara and people that wrote in. And then I also interviewed men who were of that age, grew up and were married at that age. And it's interesting, again, this is the idea about singling Ireland out. You had all of this Catholic infrastructure and the laws and the censorship and all of these sort of things. But actually underneath that, you had these couples just trying to navigate and work it out by themselves, yeah. You know? So I remember there was one man that I spoke to who didn't want to use contraception, or they couldn't get access to contraception. They didn't want to have any more children. So they just flipped their sexual life change to that he would give her oral sex. And this was in 1964. And, you know, and it just kind of really brought home to me the idea that, you know, that people were trying to work things out, you know, in a way that...
They found a workaround.
They tried to work around, you know. And you know, France, for example, had laws against contraception. Right?
Did it? Did you see, yeah, from 1920. Surely the contraception situation did single us out in a way, but no.
Well, 1920 to 1967, France legalized. But you also had a situation where, like Britain, for example, had contraception, but in so many areas you couldn't get it. So it didn't make a difference if it was on the statute book or not. Mm. The question was about access. It was about doctors. It was about this kind of infrastructure, you know, and whether it allowed you to have the sexual life that you wanted to have. Spain, similarly, which is kind of closer, I suppose, to us as well, you know, during the Franco period, a couple couldn't check into a hotel. The receptionist would ask them if they were married.
Well, one of the things that I actually like about our way of dealing with, I think a bit of Catholic guilt makes things a bit more exciting.
Yeah, but
like I wouldn't want to be Germany. You know, where they're so open about everything. It was thrilling to be doing something that I thought was sinful and bad.
I think the story about Ireland is told generally by other people, you know. Mm. We had a whole cultural nationalist movement who told us before independence that, oh, you know, Britain is this sinful, they're on the highway to hell, but Ireland, different, you know, we've higher moral standards, we've got this, we're different. You had the Catholic Church telling us that we were also different, you know. So you had all of these, you had experts, you know, anthropologists from the US coming over, writing reports about how wonderfully quaint we were, throughout, you know, the 40s, 50s and 60s. But it's only now that we're actually telling our own story.
Well, Carol, what year did you come to Ireland?
1985.
And did you sort of arrive in this is like this weird repressed place, or it was same as home?
It was very different. But I think what I really enjoyed about arriving at that time in 1986, it was just the beginning of that wave of the liberal voices and to become part of all of that.
Yeah.
Leading up to 92 and the decriminalisation, just to have participated in such a strong liberal wave was wonderful for me.
Can I jump in there? Yeah. The difference was that she arrived into the lesbian scene.
Oh, yeah.
So that was like it was a different planet to ordinary heterosexual Ireland.
Mm.
So we were finding out about sex and having sex with each other and it was radical and progressive kind of thing, you know, whereas straight girls had very little experience of having good sex with their boyfriends and stuff, you know. I mean, you could safely say that the clitoris was unknown, almost, and female orgasm. Mm. But within the lesbian world, of course, absolutely not. It was the complete opposite, you know. So it was just a different mini world,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Yeah. In J.J. Smith's on Anger Street.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But I think that movement you see happening towards in that period is, for certainly for straight women as well, it's this movement for pleasure, that there's the movement, yes, away from that. Sex was so linked to reproduction. It was so linked to duty. It was so linked, mm-hmm, to love. And then suddenly you are like, women want sex because it's pleasurable, and people and women wanted orgasms and better orgasms, yeah, and, yes, more orgasms.
He needs to do an ad for Sex Siopa. That was good. I mean, I bought that. Richie, when you're talking to young men here now, does guilt and the kind of stuff that we struggle with play into it?
We try and make it as normal and as sex positive a conversation as possible. So guilt really doesn't come into the room a hell of a lot. They wouldn't express it in those terms anyway. When we talk about porn, they'll openly, you know, in a joke way, lads, particularly at that age, 16-year-olds, like, humour is a big defence thing. In particular, there's a lot of tension when you talk about sex to a group of lads, and they'll break the tension by making a lot of jokes. So you have to harness all that energy in a really fun way. But we tease it out, really, what their attitudes are to sex.
And what is their attitude to it?
We go in, and our whole thing is, if you go back 20 years when I was sitting in that exact same classrooms, the teachers would have, if we would have had a conversation about sex, they would have assumed we're all heterosexual to begin with. And we might have been nudged into waiting to be sexually active until we were married. Now we assume there's all sorts of different sexualities in the room, and our language reflects that.
And at 16, are they open about that?
But we actually had a transition year. I don't know, maybe the media department or something had put together some video, and I think each student was invited to sit in front of the camera and just give a line that they were proud of about themselves. And some lads says, you know, I'm Joey and I'm proud of myself because I can play the spoons, or because I'm a hurler. And one fella said, because I'm gay and I'm proud. And he was 16, and I remember going, that is a world away from how 16-year-olds would have behaved when I was 16 in that school, going back to the mid-90s.
You know, I sometimes, your parents will bring their 15-year-old son to my show sometimes or something, and, you know, he's in sort of full boy makeup, you know, and everyone's fine with it. Mm. It's just an incredible change. But at the same time, then, I also still hear awful stories. You know, it's a very mixed bag, I think.
Yeah, I think when we first introduced the module, all the parents, we sent them a letter. So it was an opt-out letter. So we'd be respectful of their attitudes and whatever. We gave a rough outline of the topics we'd be bringing up and said, if you don't want your lad to be involved, that's okay, but let us know. And no one signed it. And then we got really good feedback from the parents that we were kind of facilitating chats at home that wouldn't have happened otherwise if the module didn't happen. So our aim is kind of to start chats with the lads and promote discussion from student to student.
Yeah. And now, Shawna, in a way, you've got this American accent.
Yeah.
Do you think that helps or hinders you to talk about sex largely? Because I have to say that I feel like I'm, you know, super open about these things, and God, look at me, you know. So, but when you're casually sitting there talking to me in this studio that we've often used about vibrators and stuff, it's just, it's new. Do you know what I mean?
Possibly. I think when people hear my voice, they're probably like, oh, she's American, of course she's into that.
Yeah.
And so I think in that sense, it does make it a little easier. But I suppose at the same time, I called my shop Sex Siopa for a reason.
Yeah.
You know, I've spent my entire adult life in Ireland. Mm. I moved here when I was 20, and I wanted it to be something that was for Ireland by Ireland. And I just felt like I might be the person running the show, but I wanted it to be something for everyone.
Well, how long have you been here now?
So I've been here for almost 15 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So in that, and it's a pretty remarkable, you know, period of social change in this country.
Oh, yeah.
You know, what's the difference that you've noticed in that period?
So I always say that we're much more liberal than we give ourselves credit for, just because I don't think I would have started the business if I didn't think that I couldn't sell sex toys here. Mm. I had this feeling deep inside of me that we mightn't talk about it, the media mightn't talk about it. Like, certainly in 2012, I think the most conversation we were having about sex in the media was just sort of like titillation when something bad happens, or like Page Three Girls.
Yeah.
And I wanted to kind of help push that conversation forward. And I noticed when I give talks and things that everybody, like the audience, would be completely like quiet until I say, okay, the first person who asks me a sex question gets a free bottle of lube, and then all of the hands go up.
They're must be very dry. Yeah. I wanted to ask all of you, actually, just super briefly, what would you like to see change? Or what is the advice you would give to, you know, if you were another you was appearing now? I'll start with you, Shawna. Like, what would you say to another American arriving here today to sort of prepare them for Ireland?
To prepare them for Ireland. Oh, yeah. I think we're just up for the crack when it comes to sex. Like, I know, again, we don't talk about it as much as we probably should, but I think we're definitely up for the crack.
Now, Richie, you, of course, what would you like to see change in that area?
What I would like to change, and in fairness, I think it is changing, is that we take a different approach to how we support young people in the area, in this area in particular. And a lot of it is for really understandable reasons. If it's in a classroom setting, some teachers, like adults, they come from a background where they weren't brought up in any kind of sex positive environment. They'll be loaded with their own attitudes and values and their own opinions about it. But I think for young people now, and all the umpteen challenges they face, I think we could do sex education better.
I'm going to come over this side. Paul?
I would like or wish a kind of a new conversation around sex. I think the way we talk about sex is often, I think, as we said earlier, a problem, or it's medicalized, or it's still linked to a degree of disease or harm or porn or all of these sort of things. But I think also we could have kind of a wider discussion about sex as being a positive thing, about kind of intimacy thing. I think the second thing I would really love the state to, first of all, ask young people what they include young people into a conversation about sex education and what they feel relevant. I mean, this has been done in other jurisdictions. I think that's important. We're always telling young people what they need to know. I think we need to listen a little bit more. And the state really needs to get its act together about what it wants, what vision it wants, and have that uniform across schools, because we've got this crazy situation of having a so-called national system, but of course it's not. Different schools teach different things around sex ed. Some, even religious schools, can be very positive, and others get nothing. So I think we really do need to try and standardize that and try and bring others in, parents, young people themselves, teachers, into that conversation.
Taryn, what have you learned?
I would say that improving the sexual education that young people get. But I'd also like to see a lot more supports for parents, because I think it's an area that parents really struggle with. Mm. And they don't have the language or the confidence to speak to their children about this. So I'm just going to keep pushing my sex positive agenda on Ireland for as long as you still have
Brace
me.
Brace yourselves, Donegal. Maria.
Yes.
What advice would you like to have had?
My particular angle would be for girls to discover masturbation and feel good about it. Mm. For that to literally open up more to themselves, because boys, you see, there's a very obvious early, you know, arousal and, you know, wet dreams. But for girls, it's different. There's this, it's kind of a deeper, mysterious, anatomical thing. So I think that's a thing that's crying out to be encouraged more, girls to discover their masturbation and to be self-empowering from that. Because there's a strong emphasis with kind of the guys, it's still quite male-dominated, the sexuality thing, a certain sense of male entitlement to sex. So they think that the guy gets his orgasm and that's it, that's the end of the sex act. So I think there's still a lot of ignorance about female sexuality. So bring it on for girls masturbating.
Shawna, you need to get her email address, because that's a good customer sitting right there. And now, so Zrazy, you're going to play us out.
Yes.
Carole, why don't you tell us about the song?
Oh, I'm going to tell you about the song. This is a song called Remember That You Did It First With Me.
Well, let's hear it.
from the boat. When you show her all their beauty, dissolve into remote. Remember, remember, remember that you did it first with me. When you take her to the restaurant where you dance to violins, when you whisper that you love her while the music soars and spins, remember, remember, remember that you did it first with me. I'm not looking for revenge, and I don't want sympathy. I only want what once was ours and still belongs to me. Up her body as she lies across your bed. When you slide yourself inside her body and her hair, remember, remember, remember that you did it first with. When you explore the edge of love, when you wear her silver ring, when you swear to love forever and to always tell her everything, remember, remember, remember that you did. First with me, I'm not looking for revenge. No, 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 no. I don't want sympathy. I only want what once was ours and still belongs to me. You did it first with me.
Thank you. Well, that, boys and girls, concludes our Everything You Wanted to Know About Sex in Ireland But Never Got to Ask program. Now, you can catch up on this episode on pantisocracy.ie, and you'll find some videos of the beautiful performances from Zrazy as well. And of course, you can catch up on all episodes of Pantisocracy on podcasts, which are available from all your usual and standard podcast homes. And please share, rate, and review, which is what you have to say nowadays, and it sounds appropriately suggestive today. So thank you all so much for being here with us. And that's the end of our cabaret of conversations. Thank you, and good night.